All right, how's it going, guys? EA40 here. I'm doing a little bit of a Snapchat and video inception here. You'll see that if you add me on Snapchat. Anyway, so what I was going to talk about today is the second episode of Series 23 of Top Gear, of the new Top Gear with all the new hosts and stuff like that. By now, you've probably seen my my first video and possibly my Car Throttle blog post talking about it, and you'll probably notice that my review wasn't completely negative, unlike some people on the internet, but it was not positive at all. Now, this second episode, what I have to say is, what a massive improvement. So where exactly to start? We'll start again with Chris Evans. He wasn't as shouty as last episode, hooray. Still a little bit shouty, maybe it could be toned down a little bit. He didn't try as much with emulating Jeremy Clarkson. He could do a tad better and not emulating him as much, but it's a remarkable improvement over the first episode. And I think also some of it is just that people have to get used to it, because I guess they all know that they can't replicate the old hosts and that they have to be more of themselves a little bit. And people might be complaining a bit about the Chris Evans kind of energy, but maybe that's what they kind of wanted to begin with, to help make it more of a different show. But is it better with Chris Evans? Yes, definitely. Matt LeBlanc, he was good as usual. Him and Chris Evans, maybe a bit of chemistry issues to work out, as in to just refine it more. Like for example, when they kind of bashed Eddie Jordan at the beginning with the engine size of his Mercedes, their reaction, that want reaction, it was kind of funny, but it just also felt a little bit off. But it was definitely, I'd say it was definitely a good attempt. Matt was pretty good as always. Definitely provided that nice contrast in energy and things like that. So good marks for Matt there, and definitely decent marks for Chris Evans there. I'm not so much of that, oh, we need to get rid of Chris Evans ASAP. But he's definitely made a lot more of an improvement that was definitely needed. And side notes, the beginning of the episode was, I found that to be a little interesting, because I found it kind of funny, because it seemed like by the way they had Chris Evans in that hospital bed, it seemed like they definitely read the criticism about they need to tone it down a little. So that, I think that was a creative way for them to show that, yes, we've listened and things like that. Another note, let's see, I talked about Chris Evans, I talked about Matt LeBlanc, star in a reasonably priced car, or no, star in a rallycross car. That segment, I feel a little bit like skipping it, because it just isn't that great. Even with the old trio, that segment wasn't always the best. I could see why some people would skip it. Except if you ended up skipping like the Formula One stars who came up, then that was your loss. But anyway, I also find it weird how they have the stars announce each other rather than them announcing themselves. It's like, what, really? Can't they speak for themselves? It doesn't really add in any like beneficial way. It's just weird. So I will say, yeah, the stars, let them introduce themselves. Moving on from that, the segment on the McLaren F1 and the McLaren 675 LT. Was the 675 LT really the first like radical enough one against or after the McLaren F1 Longtail? I don't know about that. They share the same name, but I think that statement was a little bit wayward. But otherwise, it was pretty well done, actually. I think it was well done. I find the camera work and stuff interesting, because I knew that with the F1, they definitely made it seem like the car was going way faster than way faster than it really was. Like with Chris Evans saying how 200 was the fastest he'd ever been in a car, I knew that they went very slow in the F1, being that that it can go a lot faster. They have the space and things like that. And I found out later in Extra Gear that due to insurance purposes, they couldn't go any faster than 70. But with Chris Evans in the 675 LT, I think he did a fairly decent job. More work to be done as he gets more experience and stuff. And then it really got better as well whenever Jenson Button was driving. For some reason, Jenson seems like he'd be a pretty good host. He also had a good sense of humor. I liked his jokes about, oh, this headliner, as he's like just flinging the car at a ridiculous speed into a corner. It's like, really, that was just silly, but it was pretty good. Too bad he doesn't have a 675 LT either. But that segment, it was pretty good. I loved the ending when they had the 675 along with a McLaren F1 side by side. That was a nice tribute and a very nice touch at the end. The whole Africa segment, the South African segment, that was enjoyable. I'd actually say that segment was better than a bunch of segments from the previous Top Gear. I'm going to go as far and say that. The hosts, for the most part, they could have done better with looking like they enjoyed themselves, but they did seem like they enjoyed themselves more. Having those three other celebrities join them, that was a very interesting idea, and I think it worked pretty well. Having all the different personalities in, and for some reason, Tiny Tempa and Matt LeBlanc, they just worked well together. I don't know, I think out of, like, in the three cars, Tiny and Matt in the Porsche Macan, I think they might have been, I did just say Porsche. And I haven't made that mistake in such a long time. Maybe because I've heard Top Gear say Porsche instead of Porsche. Anyway. So, Matt and Tiny in the Porsche Macan. I think that they were probably the best fit out of all three of them. The challenges were interesting. And the interesting thing is, a while back, I went to a Jaguar dealership. And I asked them about off-roading with the F-Pace, and they said one of the guys who had been to a Jaguar event said that Jaguar does not recommend the F-Pace for any bit of off-roading. So the fact that they did like off-road stuff and like dirt trails and stuff, I found that a little weird, to be honest. I didn't know what exactly to think about that. It's cool to show that the car's able to do it, but at the same time, it just fell a little off. But at least they had that street circuit, and that was cool to watch. I expected the Porsche to do pretty well. Jaguar, they didn't do too bad. That car didn't do bad at all. It lost, of course, but it seems like it could sort of hold up to the Jaguar spirit a little bit. So good marks for Jaguar there. Porsche, I'm not surprised. I mean, they've been at this SUV game for a good bit of time with the Cayenne. The people were like, yeah, why is Porsche making an SUV? Well, it's gone well so far. So the other thing about the Africa segment, when they did the wildlife spotting in the backup cameras, my biggest complaint with that was that they didn't turn off the on-screen graphics on the cameras, because some of those shots looked so cool with like the zebras or the zebras, depending on where in the world you're from. With the zebras going past that backup camera in the Porsche Macan, that was just so cool to watch. But the graphics. Why didn't they think to turn those off? Anyway, that was a cool part. And then we'll sort of tie this next part into one of the hosts, Eddie Jordan. Now, granted, this was his first episode, and frankly, I think he has a bit of an empty personality issue. I don't know. There was just too much that was lacking with him. I don't know exactly how to explain it. Maybe a bit of fish out of water a bit, but he has a bit of work to do with personality. And my other question is he actually a little bit incompetent? Is it about to rain? I hope not. Okay. Is he a little bit incompetent, actually? Because you might have seen the part with his Mercedes. I believe it was a GLC. And he, I don't know, twice he forgot to put it in the off-road mode. Tiny, he explained it nicely. Mountains, rocks, Africa. But I'm just thinking, was Eddie Jordan really that incompetent? That was a little bit frustrating to watch. And then because of all of that, we didn't even get to see how it performed in the off-road mode. Like, come on. Alright, so to rank the three hosts so far, Chris Evans, still some more work to do. Remarkable improvement over the first episode. Matt LeBlanc, good as always, could be tap better. There's always experience. He's just going to get better as time goes on, of course. Eddie Jordan, missing some personality and, frankly, a little incompetent. He has some work to do. Hopefully, his next episode, he'll be a lot better. Moving on to Extra Gear. Rory, he was good as always. He's not much really to say about him. I think he's just good. And then it was weird almost. It seemed like Eddie Jordan was a guest on their own show. It seemed a little weird. He explained nicely, though, about the whole cheating aspect and how really they were just playing around the rules without explicitly breaking the rules, which that's Top Gear normal, actually. So Matt and Tiny, I hope that they learn that the rules apply, but there are plenty of loopholes. So it was weird having Eddie like be a guest on his own show in a sense. Having Chris Evans talk about a bit of behind the scenes with the F1, that was a nice bit, actually. I like that. And then Chris Harris, he was absent, but I was pretty impressed with his segment. He said it was a prior engagement, so he couldn't make it. But those are some pretty cool clips that they had, and Chris, he did a great job of presenting it, as always. So good points for Chris there. So to wrap this up, the second episode up, sadly, so many people had abandoned it after the first episode, but in reality, I knew that the first episode wouldn't be that great, and the second episode would likely be better. But to those that decided not to watch the second episode, I think they kind of missed out on something, because it was definitely enjoyable to watch. It didn't feel as forced. A bit of crowd reactions. I wonder if it's still a little bit forced and a little unnatural, but time will go on. We'll see about that. But I definitely have to give it a much better marks than beforehand. So if it were going to be getting a letter grade, it wouldn't be an A, but it'd be somewhere around the B range. As a numbers rating, I don't know exactly where to put it. It's definitely above the 4.5 that I gave it, but it's below an 8.5. So, maybe a 7, I don't know, but even 7 might seem a little low, but then a little high at the same time. So we'll give it a B. We'll give it somewhere around a B rating. Not sure if it's B, B plus, or B minus, but, they have some work to do. Surely there will be better episodes as time goes on. But I can say I was definitely impressed by it. So I'm just going to wrap it up now. So thank you guys for watching. Be sure to like and subscribe. Share this channel with your friends. Add me on all my social media. And I will be catching with you guys later.